So the question is, what is the logical effort when you have a gate where the threshold voltages of the transistors are different? Okay, maybe the pull-up transistor's threshold voltage is different from that of the pull-down. How do you calculate the logical effort? Is the same way we do a calculation of the logical effort of a gate which is skewed, whose transistor sizes are skewed, because you want to favor one over the other. No matter what the gate is, at the end of the day, when you want to compute the logical effort, say for the pull-up transition, you compare it, you first create, you take the unit inverter, you scale it up by sizing. The threshold voltage of the unit inverter is fixed because you have picked a unit inverter, you are saying, this is my unit inverter. It has certain thresholds for the different transistors. That is fixed. Now you want to have the same drive strength as the pull-up, as the gate with for whose logical effort you're calculating. And to do that, you might have to do some scaling of the sizes. Right? Scaling of all the transistors. The whole gate is scaled. You do that scaling so that you have the same drive strength. Right? Let us say that the threshold voltage of the pull-up is such that for the same size, the drive current is twice that of the standard transistor. Okay, so which means now if I have a gate, say my pull-up, I have a new inverter in the pull-up whose width is 2, but his threshold is smaller, such that the drive strength of that inverter, that transistor, is twice the normal. So then how do I scale my unit inverter? I need to double the size of the unit inverter. The unit inverter's PMOS has to be 4 because it has a higher threshold, whereas my new inverter which you have with a lower threshold has for the same, you know, it drives in 2. So now what is the logical effort? Logical effort is you take your optimized, threshold optimized inverter, its input capacitance, let us take a 2-1 inverter, its input capacitance is still 3. You have to divide down by the input capacitance of the normal inverter, which is scaled to have the same drive strength. So what is the input capacitance of the normal inverter? 2 plus 1, 3 times 2, because you have to scale up the normal inverter by 2 times. So you see the logical effort has now become 4 by 6. It's less than 1. So you have created, by using lower threshold transistor, you have created another inverter whose logical effort is lower than that of the normal inverter. So the logical effort can be more than 1, less than 1. It can be different for rising, falling, it can be different for different inputs. All these are possible. It's just reflecting the, essentially it is capturing the drive strength in some sense.
So, drive strength is basically associated with the current drive. So, you're saying, even when, in any case, even when both the NMOSs are on, but the power for the current from either rails to the output only one. So, the drive strength of any gate is given by that single path.
The effective drive strength is determined not by single transistor but the whole path. Whole path, yes. That's right. So today we'll look at the delay minimization again, look at some more examples so that it will become clearer how we do this delay minimization. Let us take this example of a multi-stage path. Where we have to find the size of x and y in this circuit such that it minimizes the delay in the path A to B. That is the question. Find x and y such that delay from A to B is minimized. So how do we go about solving this problem? Well, we use the linear delay model for the delay of each gate. So let us take the first gate. In the first gate is a NAND2 gate. What is the parasitic delay for the NAND2 gate? It's basically 2. Why? Because it has two PMOSs of size 2 each, and the pull-down NMOS is of size 2. So the source drain capacitance at just the output is 6. You have to divide that by the capacitance of a unit inverter, which is 3. So that is 2. So that gives us 2. Parasitic is 2 plus logical effort of a NAND2 is 4 by 3. Right, times what is the electrical effort. Now you look at the output load. Electrical effort is output load seen by the gate divided by the input capacitance. output load is basically 3x, because there are three of these gates in parallel. So output load is 3x divided by the input capacitance, which is 8, because it's already given. The input capacitance of this gate is 8. When we have a number here 8, it means the total input capacitance of the gate. The next gate is a NAND3 gate. NAND3 gate has a parasitic of 3. You can just do the calculation. And it has a logical effort of 5 by 3. So P plus GH, right? That is the delay equation for this gate. Logical effort 5 by 3. And the output load is 2y, because it's driving two gates of the same size. Divided by the input capacitance is x. So 2y by x. Plus the delay of the final gate, which is parasitic of 2, which is NOR 2, plus 5 by 3 is the logical effort of the NOR 2, times 45 by y. That is the delay of this whole path. Now, you know, whenever you have this, you know, so you have some, if you take this equation, you have these constants 2, 3, 2, which are independent of the size, because those are the parasitics of the gate. No matter how you scale it, it remains same. So you have these variables x, y. And when you know, we have already seen how to solve this kind of a problem. Really, in this kind of a problem, I mean, you can take a differential of d with respect to x, put it equal to 0. Differential of d with respect to y, put it equal to 0, right? And when you do that, you will end up with a condition like this, that and you have, you know, you end up with this situation where you have the efforts of each one will be equal. Okay, we are not going through the math, but really the optimum delay happens, or the minimum delay happens, when these efforts, the effort of a stage effort is this product GH, that is a stage effort. All the stage efforts are equal. And when all the stage efforts are equal, that is 1. And then you multiply all the stage efforts, that gives you the total effort F. And when you do that multiplication, these variables drop off, and this product is just a constant, which is the product of, you know, 4 by 3 times 5 by 3 times 5 by 3, the product of the logical efforts and all these. It becomes 124. So we know at the optimum, all of these are the same. So that means F opt to the power of 3, because there are 3 stages, is equal to capital F. So F opt is 1/3 of F, which is 5. So the effort per stage is 5. So the delay, the optimum delay, the minimum delay is when you plug in this 5 here, right? Because this whole effort, 4 by 3 times 3x by 8, that is the effort, that is 5. So the delay is 2 plus 5. Plus 3 plus 5 plus 2 plus 5. So that is 22. So that is the delay of this path. Now, how do we get the sizes? We work backwards. We want to find size x and y. We work backwards. We basically, we know that the final effort, this is equal to 5. This whole term 5 by 3 times 45 by y is equal to 5, so you can find y. So once you find y, now you know this, in this term there is only one unknown x. Again, this is equal to 5, then you get x, and like that you work backwards. From output to input, you will get all the sizes, and then the last one should just match up. When you, if the answer is correct, this, when you just plug it in, it should come out to be f opt, right? So that's how you do it. And then once you have the size, for example, here y turns out to be 15. Okay, now in the case of a NOR 2, what is the sizing template? NMOS is 1, PMOS is 4. So PMOS is 4/5 of the total capacitance, NMOS is 1/5. Which means if my input capacitance is 15, that is what we have calculated for y, PMOS should be 12, 4/5, and NMOS should be 3, 1/5. Like that, I can work out the sizes for all the transistors in the circuit. We also have this possibility of adding buffers or inverters, right? Let us take this example to see why that makes a difference. So we have a situation where we want to drive a load of 64, and we are given the input is coming from an inverter of size 1. So let us take this path. In this path, there is only one gate, and so what is the delay of this path? Is parasitic is 1, because that is the inverter's parasitic, plus C out by C in. C out is 64, C in is 1. So 1 plus 64 is 65. That is the delay. Let us take let us say we put two inverters in this path. When we put two inverters in this path, we already know how to size the inverters. The optimum delay happens when efforts are equal. What is the total effort for this, any for this path or even this path? It is C out by C in. All the logical efforts are one. No matter how many inverter you put, the logical effort of inverters is just one. So 64 is the total effort, capital F, if you can say, is 64. So when I have two stages, the optimum effort per stage should be square root of 64, F to the 1 by 2. Right? F to the 1 by N is the optimal effort. So F to the 1 by 2, that is square root of F. So that means the first guy does the effort of 8. So that means, and then the second guy does an 8. So that means the size of this inverter has to be 8. So then each one has an effort of 8. When you do that, what is the delay? This guy's delay is 8 plus 1, 9. This guy's delay is 8 plus 1, 9. So the total delay is 18. So there is a dramatic reduction in delay from 65 for a single inverter to two inverters, that is 18. Let us go to three inverters. Again, total effort, capital F, remains the same because inverters logical effort is 1. So I can add as many inverters I want. It will not change the total effort of the path because path total effort is G times H. Capital G is product of all logical efforts in the gate, in the path. H is all the electric, the output of the path by the input of the path. So the effort per stage is F to the 1 by 3, 64 to the power of 1 by 3, which is 4. So now each stage, so that means the final inverter has a size of 16, right? 64 by 3. One before it has 4, and the one before it has 1, which is what is the input. Now let us look at the delay. The delay of every stage, let us take the first guy's delay. The first guy's delay is 1 plus 4 because his effort is 4. Parasitic is 1, so 5. Similarly, the delay of the other two is also 5. So total delay is 15. Let us add one more gate, one more inverter. Right? When we add one more inverter, now 64 to the power of 1 by 4 is what we have to calculate. That number is essentially 2.8. You have to use a calculator to calculate. You get 2.8. And then you work out the sizes. 64 by 2.8 is 23. 23 by 2.8 is 8. 8 by 2.8 is 2.8. And then you have 1. Right? So now the total delay is again, each gate is 3.8 times 4, 15. So you see that there is an optimum number of stages. If I start adding too many stages beyond this point, what happens? The delay starts increasing. It starts decreasing in the beginning, then it starts increasing. Because now each gate, every time you put in a new gate, a new inverter in the path, it comes with its fixed parasitic delay. So that keeps on now accumulating and eventually it's no longer beneficial to put too many gates. So there is an optimum number of stages. So if I were to go back and look at the equation, if there are n stages, then we know that n times f to the 1 by n is the f to the 1 by n is the optimal effort per stage. So n times f to the 1 by n plus p is the delay as a function of n. And now you can optimize this as a function of n itself. Right? You can take a derivative and put it to 0 and so on. So that's what is being done here. Let us say you have a logic block with small n1 stages. And then you add some number of buffers such that the total number of stages is capital N. You could add 0 or more buffers. We don't know what the right answer is. We just want to find that out. When you do that, the total delay becomes capital N times F to the 1. We know that effort per stage is same, F to the 1 by N. So the total delay is N times F to the 1 by N plus the sum of all parasitics, which is sigma pi from 1 to N1 plus the remaining inverters which are there, they are parasitic. There are n minus n1 inverters, parasitic of them. Now you differentiate with respect to n. Just go through some algebra. And we will just change the notation here. So here f, so let's just see d by dn is, you differentiate this term which gives me this plus n times this plus p in, because you know this comes out and p in comes. And then I replace f to the 1 by n as small f. That is the stage effort. So you put that into this equation, this n and this n square cancel, so you get simplifies to f times 1 minus log f plus p in. Now we know that minima happens when this derivative is 0, plus of course there is a condition second derivative, which is also you should check, but basically at when this derivative is 0, minima happens. So you take this equation and put it to 0, whatever answer, whatever value of f is there, f opt, you know, that is f opt. Okay, now when p is 1, this you have to solve it numerically. So iteratively you can solve it in a, using a calculator, that comes out to be about 3.5. So my optimum stage effort is 3.5 when I am allowed to change the, use whatever number of stages I want. What is the number of stages I use? I use the number of stages n such that f opt to the power of n is equal to capital F. Because the product of all the f opt should be equal to capital F. So that means n opt, the optimum number of stages is log capital F by log F. So this is how I find the number of stages. If that number of stages capital N is bigger than N1, then I just have to add that many inverters. If it is less than N1, I can't do anything. So I have to go back. I should not use this value of F opt, because if I use that value of F opt, it will not give me the right answer. I have to go back and say my capital N is equal to N1 itself. I have to use that. And then my F opt is F capital F to the power of 1 by N1. Then I size it. Whatever we have been doing in the previous examples, that's what we should do. Yeah.
For all the inverters, we have equal stage factor. No, G is 1 for all the inverters. So if it depends on H. If H is not equal to 1, then we need to have different layers of inverters.
H should not be 1. H is F opt.
So the size of inverters will
be? Absolutely. The size of the load inverter is F opt times the size of my inverter.
So if you have higher loads, then you need to have higher ranges of sizes. The scaling increases.
Scaling, okay. So the question is, the question which is being asked is, there is a scaling factor. As we go down the inverter chain, I'm using bigger and bigger inverter. In fact, the next inverter, the inverter I drive is F opt times my size, because that ratio is F opt. So what is this? If I'm allowed to use arbitrary number of stages or as many stages as I want, then the scale factor is constant, that is 3.5. It's the same, f opt equal to 3.5, that is the number you have to use for you to get the minimum delay. That is what this equation is telling you. So I adjust the number of stages such that f opt to the power of n is equal to capital F. So all you are given is the following. You go back to the previous example, you have to drive a load of 64. That is what is given to you. Okay, how many stages you use, what sizing you have to use per stage, that you have to figure out. So the answer to this question is to basically use an effort of F opt equal to 3.5 per stage. And how many stages to use? You have to take 64 to the power of, log of 64 to base 3.5. Yeah, so that will give me the number of stages. In this example, what we have done is we have choose 4, f opt is 4, because it turns out that it's very weakly dependent on, 3.5 to 4, there is a small change. But if you want to be exact, I will use 3.5 as my scale factor. And I calculate the number of stages, whatever number of stages I get, I use that. So you see what we are saying is, independent of the load, no matter what the load is, what is changing is not the scale factor of F opt, but what is changing is the number of stages. See, if my load goes up by a factor of 3.5, then I add one more stage. Every 3.5 or 4 increase in load means I have to add one more stage, while I keep the stage efforts the same. So this is what this graph is showing, is that you can look at this delay as a function of n, capital N, or a function of there's f opt. It's kind of a shallow number, shallow graph. So you can be off by a little bit, and you won't be penalized too much in terms of the delay. Because as we said, n has to be an integer. If you go back to the previous equation, you will get some real number. You have to quantize it, and you basically look at, what number will give you the light polarity, because there is a certain polarity expected here. So you have to preserve it by having even number of inverters. So you have to choose the right one. Let us take one more example, that of the design of a decoder. what is a decoder? A decoder, what it does is, usually there is an array, a memory array. Here we are calling that array as a register file. It's essentially it's an array of registers. Each register is 32 bits, and there are 16 of them. So a 4-bit address selects the register you want to read or write to. So that is the job of the address decoder. There are 16 wires out here coming out. Each wire is connected to a select line, acts as a select line for that particular register entry. There are 16 of them. So based on the address input you give, the 4-bit address pattern, that particular select line is activated. Okay, this is a common theme in any memory structure. This is how you'll have an address decoder. Now what is given is that this select line has to go and somehow get connected to the register cell. We are not going into the detail of the register cell design right at this point. All we are basically said, all we need to know right now is what is the load presented by the cell, register bit cell, onto the select line. What is being said is each load from each bit is 3 units that's being given. Since there are 32 bits, the total load seen is 32 times 3 equal to 96. So that's all we need to know. So what we have said is each of the select line has to drive a load which is of 96 units. The input inverter size is also given as 10. Now we have to, and what is being said is true and complement is also available. So they are coming in as parallel inputs. So we have to determine the right logic implementation out here, the number of stages and size of each stage, such that the delay from address bit changing to a particular select line turning on is minimized. We want really fast access. So let us take the example of a NAND 4 inverter combination. So what we have here is, see, at the end of the day, the logic function for each of the select line is essentially an AND function. It's a 4 input AND function. Why? Because and these 4 inputs had to be chosen from address or its complement. For each address bit, there are, for each address wire, there are 2 possibilities, either the address or its complement goes, and then there are 4 of them. So the total possibilities are 2 to the 4, 16 possibilities, right? So that's how you have 16 different word lines. These are called word lines or select lines, which can get activated based on just which, you have a group of 2 here, which of these 2 you put here. So for example, here A3 is being put, A2 is being put, A1 is being connected, A0 is being connected. So that means this word 0 gets activated when address is 1111. That is when this gets activated. If I look at the next one, this one gets activated when A3 is 0, A2 is 0, A1 is 0. So the last one gets activated and all the inputs are 0. So like that you have all possible, you know, 2 to the 16 bit patterns. So according to, if a bit pattern as 0, you connect the complement, address complement to it. If it is 1, you connect the 2. So that way you have all 16 possibilities. And now what we have is a NAND 4 gate. So let us look at the delay of this. Now, see, there is a certain symmetry here. If you do sizing for one of them, it's the same for everyone. Okay. So let us say the size is Y and Z. So let us take any particular path. Again, it doesn't matter whether you are taking from A0 or its complement. Let us take say from A0 going out. Let us take the delay of the first inverter. What is the parasitic delay is 1 of this inverter. It comes in here, it drives a load of Y, but it drives a number of gates. How many gates does it drive? You see that every address combines with all possible combinations of the remaining bits. There are 8 combinations. Right, so that's why, you know, so that's why the loading, the branching here is 8. So that means each input here goes to 8 gates, and that is true for all the bits. All the wires is the same story. So that's why there is a lot of symmetry out here. So you can just do the sizing for one, and it will be the same size. So the delay of the first gate is 8 times Y by 10 plus 1 parasitic. Let us take the next gate. The parasitic is 12 by 3 because it's a 4 input gate. the NMOS sizes are all 4, there is a series stack of 4, and the PMOSes remain as 2. So there are 4 PMOSes of size 2, so 2 times 4, 8 plus 4, 12 is the load of the output, parasitic load divided by 3, that is the parasitic of the NAND 4, plus logical effort of NAND 4 is 6 by 3 times Z by Y, plus the last inverter is 1 plus 96 by Z, because the load we said was 96. So again, we at the minimum delay, all these efforts, that is 8y by 10 should be equal to 6z by 3y should be equal to 96 by z. Right? That is what the optimum minimum delay condition is, equal efforts. So, and you multiply all of these, capital F is essentially turns out to be 153.6. Optimum happens when efforts are equal. So F opt is 1/3 of the cube root of F, which is 5.36. Oh. And excuse me. So the so just plug it in and you get a delay of one plus five, you just plug in the numbers, you get a delay of 22.1, because you have 1 plus 5.36 is the first guy, 4 plus 5.36 second, 1 plus 7, that gives you a delay of 22.1. So now, if we the question is, can we do better by adding some more buffers? Because you see that this effort is 5.36. If you are allowed the freedom of adding stages, we know that optimum effort is 3.5. So it means there is room here. We should be able to add some more buffers to get down the stage effort to 3.5. So let us try adding one more buffer. I have not changed the figure out here, but imagine there is one more inverter out here of size I1. In fact, I don't know how many inverters. We are leaving it free because we need to find the capital N which will optimize. So there are some number of inverters, N minus capital N is the total number of stages, and capital N minus 3 is the number of inverters I am adding out here. Because there are already 3 stages here, total number of stages is capital N, so N minus 3 is the extra number of inverters I am adding. So now we again write down the equation. Nothing changes for the first two terms. For the last term, the delay is 1 plus I1 by Z, where I1 is the size of the first inverter of the whole inverter chain. Like that we have I2, I3, etc. We'll just go, and the last inverter will be 1 plus, the delay is 1 plus 96 by IN minus 3. So now we, again, you know, the capital F doesn't change. Adding inverters doesn't change the total effort of the path. It remains the same. So that is still 153.6, but we are going to try using F opt, which is 3.5. and find the number of stages N, capital N, it turns out to be 4, slightly more than 4, I am going to quantize it to 4. Capital N is 4, I already have 3 stages, which means I need to add one more stage of inverter, just one stage of inverter, and then when we do that, the delay does come down to 21. So it does improve, so I could go down from 22.1 to 21, but polarity is wrong. So this is not what I want, so I cannot add one inverter, I need to add 2 inverters. So suppose I add 2 inverters, NAND 4 in with 5 stages, now what do I do? Now I have to go back and recalculate the optimal effort. I know I already have 5 stages. So F opt is F to the 1 by 5, which is 2.74. Now I put everything back and calculate and I get 21.7. So I have managed to improve by adding 2 more inverters. I have managed to improve the delay. Okay, it also turns out interestingly that we have also improved the power with this, but that is another story, we will come back to that later. So this is how you try it, you know, you have to kind of, it's a little bit of an iterative process. You have to just try out and see what works. Okay, and in fact, there is more iteration. We've just tried one combination of NAND 4 inverter. You can also have two stages. See, when I have a single 4 input AND gate, it can be made out of two input AND gates. That AND gate itself is NAND 2 inverter followed by another NAND 2 inverter. So like that, there are many possibilities. You can have NAND 2, NOR 2, so many possibilities are there. And really, the optimal design has to explore all these possibilities. For each one, you have to do this optimal sizing and perhaps even find the optimal number of stages. And then you have to compare across all the choices. And then it turns out that in the case of the decoder, the optimum happens, at least for this decoder, NAND 2 inverter, NAND 2 inverter. We'll come back to this again when we discuss decoders in more detail. But the point here is that there is an design exploration which needs to be done to find out the optimum design. Yes. Okay. So that decision is again there is a little bit of a judgment thing out there. It turns out that the area when we add these two inverters, it again related to power, actually it will benefit. It will turn out. But right, but there is, it kind of goes by, kind of some kind of a judgment. It's not, there is no, we cannot say this is the best. See, there is a judgment, maybe this is the kind of area you are allowed, this is the area budget, and you have to be within that. And really, that's what it comes down to. Someone has to make a judgment call that, this is too big, I cannot afford to put so much area out there. Or they say, this little bit of area is okay because I'm getting this extra benefit of, I'm reducing my, from 22.1 to 21.7, it doesn't seem like much of a reduction, right? It's just 0.4 out of 22. It's a very small reduction, but maybe in that context, it might be okay. So it's difficult to say. See, really, it's application specific, the judgment, the experience, all that comes into the picture. Some, there's a lot of other things which go in there to tell you whether that is the thing to do. That is the other thing. There is area, power, or area and delay, or power and delay. Those are two different things. So sometimes what people do is you can have a combined metric, that you can say area times power product or area times delay product. Sorry. You can, just like we are trying to minimize delay. So one rigorous approach, so-called rigorous within quotes, that at least you can use some mathematics to solve it, is to say, instead of minimizing delay, I'm going to minimize delay times area. But then you say, look, for me, area is really important. Or someone might say, look, for me, delay is really important. Then you say, okay, I'm going to, instead of minimizing area times delay, I'm going to minimize area times delay square, where you're giving more importance to delay versus area. So like that, there are a few different metrics which people have proposed, where in the absence of anything, you still want to come up with a reasonably good design, use the metric. The most popular is essentially area delay product. Right? Some people also use area delay square. And area delay, or some people also use power delay product. Right? That is kind of, those are some of the different metrics we can use to set up your equations and minimize. Let us do one more example. This is from the quiz from the last year, which a lot of people had trouble. In fact, everyone had trouble. So let me just discuss it right away. Okay, so here, again, this is a, if you look at this, we want to again minimize the delay from input to output. Output load is 960. We have to find the sizes x, y, z. But if you look a little bit closely, there's something funny out here. See, here, normally the example so far we have seen, this branching is such that y, this and this have the same size y. But here, I have given a size x. Okay, so we have to find the size x, y, and z such that it minimizes the delay. So at this point, ideally, I would pause and let you guys try to work it out. So if you are watching on the video, you can do that. But since we are running out of time, we'll just go ahead and see how to solve this problem. So, well, it turns out it's actually very simple. We just apply the same method. First, we set up the equations. Let us write the delay of the first inverter. Is 1 plus x by 3. Right? delay of the second inverter. Parasitic, this is a NAND 2, sorry, the second gate is a NAND 2 gate. Actually, so that is not specified here, but this is, all these gates are 2 input gates. So, NAND 2 gate has a logic parasitic of 2 and logical effort of 4 by 3 and the load is x plus y and the input is x. So, this is the equation. The next gate is NAND 2 again, parasitic is 2, logical effort 2 plus g, p plus dh, 2 plus 4 by 3 times h is electrical effort is z by y. Plus the final gate, which is a NOR 2, whose parasitic is again 2, logical effort is 5 by 3 and electrical effort is C out by Z, 960 by Z. So now this is the equation. Let us just simplify. The one thing we notice out here is that, you know, everything else we have seen before, this is the new one, X plus 5 by X. So if you just expand X plus 5 by X, this X and X cancels. So it just becomes 1 plus Y by X. So we, this equation can be written as 2 plus 4 by 3 plus 4 by 3 times y by x. So what has happened is this additional gate x is showing up as an extra in the parasitic component, parasitic delay. And if you think about it, it's not surprising, because when I change x, that is a property of the parasitic delay. It is kind of independent of the size of the gate, because when I increase x, this also increases. So the delay contribution by that is fixed independent of x. It's like a parasitic, so it shows up as a parasitic delay. Once we recognize that, everything else is the same as before, nothing has changed. So again, I take the total capital F is x by 3 times, so now I don't even think about this additional thing, I just say that is parasitic, it's just another gate which has extra parasitic of 2, of, you know, whose delay, parasitic delay is 2 plus 4 by 3. So now my total effort is just product of the individual efforts, which is, you multiply all these efforts, that comes out to be 948.1, and there are 4 stages. So F opt is capital F to 1 by 4, 5.54, and then you plug it in and you get the minimum delay, and from, you can also get the work out the size ZX, ZY and X by working backwards. Okay. So to summarize, what we have seen is this logical effort is a way to compare the efficiency of the gate with a standard inverter, where we compare the ratio of input capacitances while keeping the drive strengths of the gate and that of the inverter the same by doing the appropriate scaling of the inverter as required. I might have to scale up or I might have to scale down also, because we have to just make sure the drive strengths are the same for each transition, because logical effort is a per input per transition number. And we saw some examples. There are a couple of other examples in the textbook also, so you can kind of go through it. For example, there are these gates, like for example, there is a pseudo NMOS gate where the input only gets connected to the pull down stack. The pull up is just a standard PMOS connected to ground. So again, you can calculate the logical effort of such a gate, similar to what we have seen, by making sure you compare it with the inverter, standard inverter, whose drive strength is the same. And what we also saw was the paths are fastest when all the stage efforts are equal of the gates in the path. That's kind of a rule of thumb. But really, you can go back to the delay equation and minimize the delay equation and so on. From there, you get this condition for simple delay paths. Then we have that when we are allowed to put padding, that means we are allowed to put buffers like inverters, then there is a optimum stage effort, which is 3.5, independent of the logic gate and etc. And then but then you have to use the right number of stages to get such that the total effort is obtained. The optimum effort 3.5 to the power of number of stages should be the total effort of the path. So, you know, this, of course, this kind of approach has a limitation. This logical effort is very good for us to understand these gates and understand delay, what affects delay, buffering, etc. But detailed, precise numbers and final optimum values is better to use a more detailed SPICE simulator, because this delay model is, it's based on a simple linear delay model. It ignores slew times, like rise times. We'll see how rise times affect delays. It's a second order effect, but then when you are really optimizing for the last picosecond, sometimes we have to take in these more advanced second order effects. Also, when we have interconnect, we have kind of not dealt with that here. If you have fixed interconnect capacitance, how do you deal with that? Right? It requires some iterations to solve this. And then really this logical effort based delay optimization is essentially for delay minimization. If you have other considerations like delay area, delay power product, or different weightages of power and delay, that we cannot handle with this. We have to augment this formulation with some additional things. Okay, so with that, we come to the end of this lecture.